Okay. Then we start into the day with Christian Köntop from Booking. He's been here several times, which is always a good thing, and will be this year, I'm sure. So, yeah, thank you for coming and leading over to you.
Yeah, I think I'm earning my third star by now. My name is Christian Köntop. I don't do Twitter, but I have a Google Plus URL. I'm working for, I used to say, a small travel agency in Amsterdam, but after last year's year-end party, I can say that this is no longer true. I'm in the business of bringing people to bed, 1 million people every day. And in order to do this, we need to maintain one or the other database. And this is the story of an upgrade, or it should have been, because it didn't work out. We agreed on the topic for that talk pretty early. And my thinking was by that time we would already be running MySQL 5.6 throughout the organization. That means that we would have been upgrading 2,000 databases to the current version. We would be able to do this, but that would break several things. So by now we are still holding back the upgrade, but the infrastructure to actually do this is in place, and this talk is mostly about the infrastructure. So the content is all there, but I don't have the proof of we have been already doing this is missing. The reason that we haven't been doing the upgrade is a bit unclear. It is most likely that there are a few interesting new features in the optimizer, and the optimizer is apparently a bit overly enthusiastic in using these features. So that there is a slight discrepancy in performance. It's not that bad, really, but we don't want to go all out on 5.6 before we understand the problem completely and have a fix in the work. I need to introduce our database environment a bit in order to understand, in order to make you understand our way of thinking and our priorities in engineering when it comes to all this. We have not a lot of data. All in all, it's throughout the organization about 14 terabytes of unique data in the databases. All the big stuff by now is in Hadoop. So by terabytes of archive data, we only go to 73 terabytes. That's also not that big. I have 12 terabytes at home. So 14 terabytes in the organization is really not that much. The MySQL databases are using not quite 500 terabytes in space total, and it's about 2,000 instances. The problem, the discrepancy and everything else that comes from that is we have about 7 DBAs for all of this. So if a DBA is ever going to use SSH to log into a box in order to look something up, it is a clear sign of their monitoring being broken. If a DBA ever logs into a box in order to change something, it is a clear sign of automation missing or being broken, and that needs to be fixed. The only legitimate use of SSH in the organization really is the Git connection to the Puppet repository. So you're pushing a change, and then Puppet is doing the rest. This is CentOS Apache. It used to be mod Perl in Apache. It is now Pluck. And MySQL 5.5 moving to 5.6, and then quite a lot of custom local tools. If you look at the server versions in an overview, it is mostly 5.5.16, 5.5.5.23. It is quite a bit of, you can see this here, 5.6.5, that is a beta, not a release version, and 5.6.10 here. And we are able to change this within 20 days to all 5.6, and the talk is really about how we are going to do this and why. The infrastructure more or less looks like this. For every database, the front-end web servers are talking in a two-tier architecture more or less directly to the master database, and quite a lot of read-only slaves depending on the schema and the hierarchy we're talking about. But all the writes go to an active master. That active master has a standby. This shares a virtual IP for this, and actually the same virtual IP is also used by the slaves. That need not be any more longer. You can have a different virtual IP for the slaves, even put this on a different interface, and so use different physical infrastructures for replication and production node traffic. These two machines share a filer, so we have shared data, and we have a mobile virtual IP here. We have all the slaves, and among all the slaves in every application hierarchy, we have a clone source, which we can use to produce more slaves, and we have a backup slave that is being used to produce the backups. We have a disaster recovery data center. In the disaster recovery center, there is another master that is a slave to the actual master. And that is then having the same setup, exactly the same setup, as in the production data center. So we have a 2-deep replication hierarchy for normal production. And within the disaster recovery data center, as long as this is in standby, it is 3-deep. 3-deep replication hierarchies have a few synchronization problems. That would be an interesting topic for another talk, not for this one. This is a cold standby. It is by now using a filer that has a set of problems in its own, because replication is single-threaded, and filers have a higher communication latency than local disks. So replication on the filer, on this machine especially, is usually lagging first. The first sign of replication capacity being reached is when this machine has a replication delay, because you can do, because of the single-thread nature of replication, you can do about 2,000 queries per second in replication on this box. You can do many more on these and on these, because they have local disks, less latency, and especially if this is using a local SSD, it can go much faster even with single-threaded replication. This setup also has the migratory VIP, and while we could easily set up something like Heartbeat or similar, we are not actually doing this, because when we did that, we found that the cluster software failed more often than the hardware, so we stopped doing this. We have all the scripts to actually move this over, but we usually have a human doing this and continue to do this, at least in the master databases. In other environments or with other systems, we are using instead the cluster software. The master hardware is your average DL380 or 360, depending on the need of local disks. It has 12 physical cores, it has 200 gigabytes of memory, and if it's a 380, it has 6 local disks, so 3 pairs of disks. If it is a 360, it is using a filer instead. The slaves don't have to be reliable, because the field replaceable unit is basically the entire blade. So if a slave fails for whatever reason, we kill the slave and make sure that we have enough of them. This is in processing power and memory equivalent to a master, but it has less disk drives, and most new database blades by now have simply one SSD in there, and we don't care about RAID anymore, because when that box dies, we have another for that. We are trying to move most of this away from rotating Rust by now and try to build our production databases, especially the customer-facing ones, with SSD, because that gives us way more I/O per second and way less latency, and also a much better behavior under high load. The entire 5.6 story started last year in May, when we had a use case that basically broke 5.5. We have hotel availability data in the AV database. The AV database is basically a setup where you have for each hotel, for each room type and each date, you have a price. So you want a comfort room in this hotel over there for the 24th of June in 2013, and this setup gives you the price. It also gives you the booking constraints, so you must stay with a Saturday in your stay, or at least 3 days or whatever, in order to qualify for that price. So the availability database also contains a pointer from the price to the policy that needs to be fulfilled in order to be offered that price. All of that is pretty normalized. And that is good, because that allows for fast changes and fast writes. But if you look at your typical web application, you have way more reads than you have writes. So what you would do is normally to you would create a materialized view. The problem is that the materialized view here is about 12 terabytes or so of derived data from the actual data over here. And you need about 24 CPU hours of about 200 cores in order to produce this. So we set up a work queue where we write entries for each change that has been performed here as a queue entry here. And then we build a bunch of workers that take items out of the work queue, fetch the data, and process this into the denormalized read optimized form as quickly as possible. And we can then point the browsing when you look at a hotel or at a bunch of hotels in order to make your booking decision to this. Only the actual booking needs to look at this data because that is always up to date and that is the leading data source. So when the actual booking happens, you're looking at the actual current denormalized normalized data over here and not at the denormalized data, which may lag a tiny bit over here. If there are enough rooms in a room type, that doesn't matter. And if there are very few rooms available for a given date in a given hotel, then there is a concurrency situation anyway. So it might be we already prepare the customer by saying only 3 rooms of this type left, book now. And it may be if they are too slow, even if we were producing it from this data, that by the time that they decide to book that the rooms are gone. So the expectations are set properly. And it normally does not create an impact in conversion or a bad user experience because the expectations in the booking user are set up properly. The problem here is that these databases here, and there are multiple, they see a really tremendous amount of writes. We can produce a data stream of about 150 megabytes per second random I/O. To each of the databases here, only that MySQL 5.5 is in no way set up to handle 150 megabytes of random I/O, even if the hardware can do that. If you build databases here with a RAID 0 of SSDs, you can get per SSD about 250 to 300 megabytes per second linear I/O, and not quite as much, but almost as much in random I/O, because random I/O in an SSD doesn't matter really if the actual I/O unit is big enough. So a MySQL 16K page or a MySQL 1 megabyte segment, when it's written, the SSD can handle that even with random I/O quite nicely. But what happens is that MySQL 5.5 dies. It dies in NODB internal logs, because if you have 24 virtual cores and hyperthreading hitting the write logs in NODB in concurrency, then 5.5 simply dies. And the other thing is that you have a redo log where all changes are logged in linear of writes, and that in 5.5 is limited to 4 gigabyte maximum. And if you have 200 gigabytes of memory, having a change log of 4 gigabyte is never enough to create a proper amount of dirty, delayed, written back pages in the MySQL in order to get a proper write rate. So instead of a wanted 150 megabytes per second sustained writes, you get a short amount of very fast writes, about 150 megabytes a second. And then you get a database that goes into panic flushing mode, and that writes about 15 megabytes per second, which is completely a waste of money in an SSD setup and also does not meet performance requirements by a factor of 10. If you go to 5.6, and we tried with 5.6.5 first time, you have less global logs because InnoBase has been completely overhauled. You set up a 32 gigabyte redo log. That gives you about 24 gigabyte of active redo log when you write this, and then it stabilizes. And it actually, with 200 concurrent writers, 24 cores, 200 gigabyte of memory, 32 gigabyte of redo log, you then get about 150 megabytes per second out of this setup for hours and hours and hours going on. this is really nicely. You then run into firmware bugs in HP SSD hardware, and you are burning through an SSD every week or so. Not because the SSD is actually broken, but because the firmware on it is broken. They can be flashed back to life. But before we found that out, we thought that we had arrived that it's actually burning out an SSD every week. So we were thinking of installing small chutes with spare SSDs in the back of the blades and having an auto-eject mechanism whenever we are through one. But it turns out that SSDs are actually not that unreliable. They also have an expected lifetime counter, and that is now coming down nicely with four-digit day numbers. So we have expected lifetimes of 5,000 or 4,000 days in the SSD lifetime timers. And if we trust them, this is HP, so we don't trust them, but if we actually were to trust them, then this is within the useful lifetime of that box, even under full write load. And the full write load we have only under initial setup, that we needed that 150 megabytes per second in order to make an estimate for the maximum time to repair. Under normal operation, we have less write load. We then ran into problems because that beta had an interesting bug. If you have two readers and information schema on the NODB transaction table, and you had a read-only transaction open at the same time, begin, select, select, commit, then MySQL simply crashes. We now know that writing a core dump of 192 gigabyte busy memory takes about 15 minutes. And the redo log recovery when the database comes back of 24 gigabyte of redo log also takes about 15 minutes. So you have a downtime on one of these blades of about 30 minutes before it comes back. That's a bit annoying. It is also annoying because the SSD has 800 gigabytes, so four core dumps fill up the SSD completely, leaving no room for data at all. The core dump compresses nicely, but still the upload to Oracle for analysis takes quite some time and also breaks the support system. So they point you to an FTP server, which is also interesting because it creates security problems. It is completely unencrypted as a transfer, and whatever is in the memory of that box might or might not be security relevant. So you need to set up encryption with them first, which is also something that actually requires quite some coordination between two organizations to make it work. The workaround for the crash bug, the immediate workaround, is turn off monitoring. So you're flying the entire setup blind through peak season because we have our monitoring running, looking at information schema tables. We're saving this for a week in a round-robin fashion. And the Oracle monitoring, the MySQL Enterprise Manager, is also reading the same table. And whenever our monitoring and their monitoring are reading this table and a read-only transaction is open, the database dies. That is then fixed in a later version. So the immediate fix was this, and a month later we have the fix, deploy this. So that is also fine. We had a second similar showstopper in a later version, and that was also fixed then by a new release pretty quickly. In September, we are through the all-year high for that year, and the situation was pretty good because without that 5.6 and the materialized view data in the availability data, we really wouldn't have made it through the summer peak with acceptable response time on the customer-facing part of our organization. So we have a beta version of MySQL running at the core of our business, rather well, if you are not touching the parts that are broken. And the parts that are broken are actually not that many. This is a typical MySQL release. The new features tend to be buggy because nobody has tried them. Also, some new features tend to be useless because nobody outside of product management has a look at them. But the previous features, those that have already been exposed to customer stuff, are actually pretty well tested by now, and they have greatly improved. And really, if you look at the 5.1 releases or the 5.0 releases that had large two-digit numbers before they became usable, I think 5.0.36 was the first usable 5.0. 5.1.45 was the first usable 5.1. And we have 5.6.5s and 5.6.10s now as a useful beta for us and the stable release. You can see that Oracle has improved the MySQL engineering organization tremendously. This is really something that you can congratulate Oracle because that was the most stable beta experience that I ever had with MySQL. That was really impressive. And the performance gains, especially with high write load and with SSDs under this, are something else that is really something they have done really, really, really well. So in late 2012, we came up with a cunning plan because over Christmas, the traffic on the site is lowest, and that is a good time of the year to make big changes if everybody were there and not at home doing Christmas. But around that days, there is usually the time for big changes and for big rollouts. So we set ourselves a migration goal. If 5.6 comes out as stable, and we are satisfied with the result, we want to be able to move all production databases to the current version in less than 30 days, in less than 20 workdays. Each of these databases has quite a bit of data. So if we actually have to copy over the data, that would create a situation for the network engineering department. Also, it is pretty clear that you can't do this if you ever have to touch a box. So we need to fully automate that, and then we need to build something on top of the automation that controls the automation in a way that the functioning machines in a pool are never below whatever we need to fulfill the service level agreement at that point in time. And we call this thing on top of automation orchestration. Yeah, so we are telling the puppets in a pool, this bunch of machines goes out of the pool, changes puppet class, and then is warmed up, is validated, and then is pushed back into the pool with the new version. Then we take the next chunk out, upgrade this, validate the upgrade, push them back, and so on. And this is something that Puppet cannot do very well, so we needed to come up with something. And look, Mom, no hands. Once the decision is made to go, the entire process must be with exactly zero humans involved, because otherwise it would not finish in time, it cannot parallelize properly, and you would run into quality problems. So you want to test this to a degree that you can be pretty confident that it doesn't break, and then you want everything you produce to be broken in exactly the same way. And that is why no humans allowed. We have had a bit of experience with our migration from 5.1 to 5.5, and that was really, really, really painful and slow because we couldn't use MySQL upgrade for reasons that are almost entirely our fault and a small bug in the MySQL upgrade script. But what we did was then we created an initial 5.5 slave underneath a 5.1 master. So we have a lot of 5.1 slaves and one 5.5 slave to a 5.1 master. And then we clone the data from the 5.5 to all the 5.1s. We take a 5.1 off, we clone the data, it is 5.5, now we push it back. And we push it underneath the 5.5 slave. So we are creating temporarily a three-tier replication hierarchy. And eventually you have a 5.1 master, you have a 5.5 master, you have all slaves underneath the 5.5 master, and then you shoot the 5.1 master into the head, and you have a 5.5 hierarchy completely. The problem is that this moves terabytes and terabytes of data at speed, and it takes still ages to complete, even with gigabyte networking to all the gigabit networking to all the nodes and the complete 10 gig backbone. So with what network engineering can deliver and with the data volume we have, it is not possible to complete the task in time. That is not a viable solution. We need to come up with other things. What we want is we want to be able to control all subsystems in a service to allow mass operations without affecting availability and quality of service for a given service. And this is how we wanted this to look. with this component here in the middle, that is something we didn't have at that point in time. We had a statically attached setup here. These blades in this cell are pointed directly to their database. These blades here in this cell are pointed to this database fixed and directly. This is pretty much, for example, the old WebDE freemail setup or something like that, the cell setup. And what we wanted to do is we wanted to introduce here a VIP and a load balancer that allows us to create this double diamond structure. Because this then allows us, for example, also to do rolling maintenance on all the databases, upgrades as well as configuration changes that require a restart and other things. With this plan in mind, we came up with a list of plans needed. What we needed is a central controller, that is the orchestration part. We need service group definitions, which boxes belong together, what is the SLA for the group, and what are the dependencies for that group, because their SLA also affects the SLA of that group. We need a mechanism that allows us repointing or load balancing of database connections on running databases. And we need a faster data distribution mechanism in case Oracle fails us again. So we need a mechanism that allows us to push data across the network without breaking the network and still doing it in time. What we already have is ServerDB. ServerDB is a Python Django-based application that does our asset and configuration management. That defines the necessary groups, can also easily define more groups. And this is also what drives our Puppet, which generates our Nagios and Graphite configurations and pretty much controls everything else. It also generates the Pixie boot setups, it generates the Kickstart configurations, and we have jobs that generate my.confs automatically from ServerDB and a few other things. This is what it looks like. I'm looking at DQS, at test systems here. You can see here the Puppet classes that are assigned to this. You have pointer to the graphite configuration and see the CPU graphs of the boxes here. You have the database version and database configuration thingies here. You have operating system info, operating system architecture, and if you go more to the right, you would also see a bit of hardware data. This is just the overview. You can click into anything here. You can click here, you end up in the graphite. You can click here and edit the configuration for that box. And then the monitoring, configuration management, Puppet, Kickstart, and other things would kick into action and set that box up. You can also use this to take them into the load balancer, take them out of the load balancer. And this also has a REST interface, so you can write command line tools to control all that in batches. We also had other parts that we were not happy with, and that was a major change for the DBA team. We had a bunch of shell scripts that did database maintenance, and shell scripts are not scaling very well if you have a multi-developer organization, and they're also not very secure and reliable, and they have really, really crap error checking. So one part that needed to be rewritten, and that triggered basically a complete rewrite of all the DBA tools, was the clone script that created new databases. That has a few interesting features. For example, in the DBA database, it maintained an inheritance hierarchy. So if we find in a clone database a faulty data, we can trace this back using the cloning hierarchy. This has been inherited by that had been inherited by that, and we can see where the error was introduced. And from there, then walk back the tree downwards to fix that problem in all things that have inherited from the faulty database. And the clone script, the core of the clone script is really just a data shovel. It is driven by ServerDB and the ServerDB state machine. So a box is set to delivered, it is pixie booted, it is set to operating system installed, it is set to active in Puppet or inactive in Puppet, and active and inactive in the load balancer, and so on. And that clone script uses rsync, and underneath that SSH, and that is not fast enough, especially because the SSH part is limited for several reasons. SSH encrypts, but not particularly fast. It is limited to one single CPU. We have many. It need not be fast, or didn't need to be fast in the past because it was running unattended. But if you want to do a mass rollout of this, then you need something better. We are keeping the legacy bash scripts, but we are building dbang or dbang, which is the Python-based dba thing. There is a dba command, a bit like git with subcommands, and that implements then all the dba day-to-day operations as Python classes and Python scripts. This allows far better reuse. It allows, for the first time ever, proper error reporting and greatly improved robustness. And for the first time, also produced something like security in the entire setup, because you really can't harden shell scripts. There is no way to do this. It uses less processes. It creates less connections because shell scripts start stuff all the time. And for example, MySQL command line clients, MySQL-E in a shell script, makes a connection, tears it down, makes a connection, tears it down. So the Python stuff is also much, much faster. Python has proper threading and concurrency control, so we can now also properly, in a multi-threaded environment, do stuff with multiple things in parallel and control that properly. We needed faster data distribution. We have a netcat re-implementation in Python, and that is faster than rsync and SSH. This is now used in the cloning and backup scripts, and is working well. It is still a script, but it is working at network speed. It is capable of saturating the network. It does not scale in the way that it can overload the network if at the receiving end are very many machines that you want to install in parallel, because you're then pushing the data in very many copies through a single gateway bridges or routers, so that it can still overload the network. And we have a modified BitTornado client that knows about network hierarchy, routers, and subnets and stuff like that. And that is used in mass cloning. So you send up the dedicated clone source as a BitTorrent tracker, and then you're using a bunch of BitTorrent clients that shovel the data between themselves. And because they know about network topology, they do this within one subnet, trying to leave the switches alone. So basically, the tracker pushes the data into one subnet once, and from then on, it is being distributed automatically within that subnet, and is being shared between the nodes in that subnet. That can mass set up one group of databases underneath one bit of infrastructure without disturbing network engineering at all. So rsync is still the default method. It is the secure default. And unless you are in a specific mass deployment scenario, that is what is being used. And the NC and torrent options provide scaling options that use less CPU and create or use less network bandwidth for the entire setup. Next problem to be solved is repointing. You have the fixed setup between a set of front-end blades and the database these blades are talking to, and you need to solve that somehow. So this is the old setup. You have the load balancer, you have the front-end blades for something, and you have the databases these front-ends talk to. The front-ends are using a configuration file, etc/bookings/db.conf. That is controlled by Puppet. And that creates a fixed relationship between the front ends and the databases. That is broken, but it did work until now. So we had no reason to change it. It is very slow to change because Puppet runs are required. It is hard to control because the Puppet runs are hard to control. You can kick them. But there still is a somewhat asynchronous configuration change across all the boxes in a cluster. And vacating a database or evacuating a database, pointing all the front ends away from a database, it is not an atomic operation. It is something that you need to check and wait and check and wait until you find the database to be empty. And then you would eventually make the change to the database once you're sure that the database is empty. You have very bad error backpropagation. When a database fails, the front ends throw errors, and that the F5 will eventually notice and drop the front ends out of the load balancer. And that is a slow and hard to control process. And you have big capacity losses when a database fails. You're losing all the front ends in the cell. Basically, you're losing the entire cell. While at our size and capacity, that is not really a problem, it is an annoyance. So the goal was a DB8 controlled local change that is immediate. And we needed something as a temporary hack to get going. And we needed also a longer project that produces a better long-term solution. So our immediate non-solution is IP tables. We have a Python method reflect that basically runs IP tables and sets up NAT so that the dbconf still points the connections to the database in question where you want to perform maintenance, but this NATs all the traffic to the other database where you want to point it to. That solution has one redeeming feature. It works right now. Everything else about it is but ugly, and you really shouldn't be doing it, except when you have to. Okay, we wanted the proper solution. The proper solution would be database level load balancing. So I asked my MySQL contacts and my ex-customers and other people that I know about database load balancing, are you doing it? And what I get was silence. So, what are you using as a load balancer for your databases? No answer. What are typical implementation pitfalls? No answer. Which was a bit discouraging, really. Then we have been looking at various solutions. One of these was using HAProxy. The problem with HAProxy is that it is an application level gateway in the default setup, so you're routing the traffic through the HAProxy and back. And HAProxy is one of these incredibly cool single-threaded, event-driven things that completely do not scale because I have a 24-core machine and this is able to use 1/24th, 2.5% of the entire box. And we already knew with the MySQL Enterprise Monitor and the Merlin MySQL proxy that this idea completely doesn't scale and needs to be killed on site. So HAProxy, no. We experimented then with Linux Virtual Server in direct routing mode because that is what WebDE did at that time and for them it worked. The bulk traffic, especially the response traffic, is going direct and not through the load balancer. The queries are going through the load balancer, but that is not a problem. But it relies on a very ugly ARP hack, which also requires that all the boxes you want to load balance are in one single broadcast domain. And unfortunately, while the WebDE web app allowed that, for example, the network setup at that time, our network setup did not allow that at all. So that had to die as well, which is unfortunate because it is kind of cool, even if it's ugly. So we modified HAProxy because most of our database connections are coming from a Perl class called BookingsDB. We modified BookingsDB so that it asks HAProxy about which database should I actually be connecting to. And you're using HAProxy as a redirector. You have basically no traffic whatsoever through the load balancer. All connections are still directly between BookingsDB on the front end and the actual database, only that the connection is not fixed, but at runtime. You're introducing for every connect one additional RTT. That's a problem. But you have zero traffic through the load balancer, and you can make it fail-safe in that if the HAProxy goes away for whatever reason, you make it stick to the last target it had. So you're basically in the same situation you were before with the dbconf. You can also make it fail back to a dbconf if you want, if the HAProxy goes away, or have other fail-safe behaviors. This did run as an interim solution. It was a great success, but it introduces a bit of latency. And we then took UBDNS and HAProxy and turned HAProxy into a DNS server, really. We created very short-lived HAProxy-controlled DNS entries and are using then normal DNS resolution and HA proxy to repoint connections to the databases. So the front end resolves the virtual database name through an HA proxy called DNS server. And that also catches all the setups that are not using BookingsDB, but are using DBI and DBD MySQL directly to connect to a database, or that are even using stuff that is not using Perl to connect to the database. That works with straight connections. And that is what we have currently very successfully in production. So now we have the new safe redesign, which is being rolled out very slowly. And all new projects are using this. And a lot of the old stuff is still using IP tables for repointing. But either way, we have mechanisms now that allow automated rolling restarts. And we have wrapper scripts for this as a proof of concept. So you have the actual action that you want to perform on a set of databases, and the wrapper controls this and the load balancer and a few other things in order to apply the actual change script to every box automatically. And that does work unattended. It also enhances capacity, at least the load balancer does, because you now have a single queue and multiple consumers. That is a simple queuing theory thing. If you have one producer and one consumer, and you have a certain latency for processing of the items from the queue, connect requests or database queries, and you're now introducing three times faster boxes, then you're cutting latency by a factor of three, and you're also improving capacity because the curve under load will become... Have you ever seen the hockey stick curve for a load test? You're ramping up offered load to a box, and the database is... Okay. And the database or everything else who consumes the load is having enough capacity to process this. Eventually, you're reaching saturation, so the entire thing, if you're lucky, levels off. And if you're still offering more load to the think time that you need to process the item, you're adding wait time. So if you look at latency under offered load, you're getting something that ramps up very, very slowly because the think time almost stays constant until you reach the saturation point, and then you're adding wait time to the think time. So you're getting something that goes like this. That's the hockey stick. And that is a very extremely nonlinear behavior. So you are getting no warning. You're loading the box up until you're reaching saturation, and then you die very suddenly because you're driving it against the wall. You're offering more and more load, which is not processed, so your wait time goes through the roof, and that means that your requests eventually die. When you're upgrading boxes to, say, three times faster CPUs, you're cutting latency down, so the think time goes down by a factor of three. And the other thing is that the hockey stick becomes even sharper. You're basically pulling this hyperbolic curve into the corner so that it becomes sharper. That means that you need to load test and benchmark more because you need to know where the saturation point is, and you need then in production to stay the fuck away from that because it kills you. And the faster your boxes are, the lower your latency is, the faster and the less warning you die. If you are building a single queue system with multiple consumers, say you are installing not faster boxes, but three times more boxes, you get a behavior where the latency stays the same. Because as long as you have spare capacity, your old boxes process stuff in think time, which is the same because the new boxes, there are more boxes, but they are not faster. And when you load up the thing, it is not one box that is busy, but three, because you installed three times more. So you get the, under load, you get the behavior from the upgraded system. Under load, it behaves like the three times faster system. Unloaded, and when you are in pure think time, it behaves like the single slow box before upgrade. So for this behavior, for this setup here, single queue, multiple consumers, you get a curve that unloaded is like the slow curve that is not as steep, and under load, it moves gradually over into the behavior of the faster system. So the behavior curve for this here is like going from the flatter curve to the sharper curve under load. That means that basically that under load, if you saturate it, you get the behavior of the faster system because you have more capacity. That means you are enhancing the capacity of your system. Even if you are not doing something for the latency, you're doing something for bulk capacity. Unfortunately, you also get the sharp behavior of the fastest system, so you need to load test properly in order to be able to stay away from the saturation point. You really, really, really need to know how your system behaves under overload so that you actually know when there will be coming smoke out of it, out of which part will the smoke come and what color is it. Only then you are able to safely drive this in production. Orchestration then, the DBA command inserts commands into a job queue. The DBA command also is using Django and MySQL backend, and there is something you shouldn't build. That's a queue in a database. But the job frequency in this queue is so low that it actually works. So we have a job table in a MySQL database that drives this. We then have task runners that fetch jobs from the queue and execute them. And there is a sequence here for clone database, for example, that repoints the target database that you want to regenerate. So all the connections that go to that database are being deflected either in the load balancer or through IP tables to somewhere else. It changes the message of the day. It checks that the database is idle. It takes the MySQL down. It then actually performs the job, whatever the DBA command tells it to do. It then starts the MySQL. It runs the warm-up procedure so that the InnoBase buffer cache isn't empty, because if you put a database that is not warmed up into the load balancer will eject it immediately. It will undo the message of the day change, and it will then unpoint the database so that connections go to this database again. And that is something where the DBA does this. DBA something whatever to this box, and all of this here happens unattended, and you get the result eventually on the status web page in the Atlassian wiki, where you can put SQL queries in wiki pages that will then dump the results of the tail of the job queue so that you can see which jobs are active and what their outcome is. So you can do something like DBA downtime, 2 hours, crisis testing. Or you can do something like DBA clones from dedicated source, and you give a source, and the target is where you are. Or there are other versions of that command where you can give source and destination host names, and you can run it from anywhere. Or you DBA torrent get share from a path. Or you DBA retrieve your new configuration, or you DBA warm up, or whatever. And some of these are actually calling other DBA commands in order to perform whatever they need to be able to do, and they are dependent on successful completion of the previous job in order to execute the next stage. You have a central queue, you have central error reporting, you have load balancer statistics from the F5 and from the HA proxy, so you have a central real-time status information about the entire system, and that is synchronous, it is real-time. It is written in a proper programming language, so it's reliable and secure, and that allows you to do stuff. You have group definitions from ServerDB, you have the DBA command, so you have a centralized orchestration controller that knows about capacity limits from the load test, from the real load test, and it can then do stuff to databases in parallel, in mass, without people actually staying there and doing hand-holding. You then have modified Isinga or Nagios checks that know about service groups from the ServerDB and that do not care at all about failures of individual boxes, but that will alert on availability in service groups. So if you need 50 slaves in the BP replication hierarchy to be on top of everything, you have 70, and the number of available slaves falls by more than 3 slaves in a 10-minute interval, or there are less than 60 slaves, then you get an alert. But individual boxes dying for whatever reason does not alert. Mass death alerts, no matter what the pool size is. Service group depletion alerts. But individual box failures is not something we care about out of office hours. We then, yeah, this is just a bit of monitoring porn here. We are using Graphite, and we have Merlin re-implemented as an Etsy dashboard on top of Graphite, because that actually scales. So usually you, with the Graphite data, you have solved the problem by the time the original MySQL Enterprise Manager has finished rendering the page. But we are a bit special. We are operating the MySQL Enterprise Manager about 30 to 50 times out of spec in number of boxes. We have Isinger with auto-generated checking scripts and data from the ServerDB. And the Merlin is still running, but you really can't use it because the Merlin with 1,000 nodes instead of the 30 it was built for does not perform, no matter what hardware you give it. We have the DBANG dashboard self-written. We have control rooms for the business level monitoring. And we have something that collects all errors anywhere in a central log and then has HTML frontends that give you error graphs and error tails on your subsystem directly to the developers, no matter where you are or where your boxes are. And that is the show errors page, which sounds pretty harmless, but is actually eating quite a lot of data from everywhere and then redistributing that. That is a wiki page that has SQL queries in here that give you, for example, a box name. It then tells you here, this is a BPRDB, this is the version running, this is the pointer to the ILO interface, to the ServerDB entry, to the MySQL D log, to the config change for and the global variables for that database. And here it gives you hardware statistics, disks available or dead, or whatever else there is known about the hardware. This is the Graphite monitoring in the ServerDB. So you have here various box names, statistics about that, and you have here memory use, CPU use, and other graphs. And this is the Etsy dashboard with here replication delay graph, and here a graph that uses performance schema to time the CPU slices of the SQL thread. So when you see the upper blue here going away, and the other data here touching the 100%, you know that the SQL thread is busy, and you will notice that here you have a very, very small violet spike, and that coincides here with the replication delay spike. So the SQL thread was busy, and because the SQL thread was busy, we have had replication delay. And if you look at the process list snapshots that we gather every minute and store for a week, you can then also see what the replication thread was doing while there was replication delay. So it is pretty easy to debug this. The management point of view to the entire thing is that strategically we are management commitment from senior management is that we are an agile organization. That means that we value velocity, development speed over all other factors. We are doing efficiency, we are doing other performance things, but only as far as we need to in order to satisfy customer requirements or business requirements. But what we want to be is an agile organization that allows us to try out new code fast. The task of the operations department is to enable the development department to be fast, to have a high velocity. That is a clearly defined supporting role. So it is the developers, for example, that are allowed to break databases. The DBA cannot stop them from doing this. The DBA can advise them, if you do this, this will hurt you because you will be offline. But it is the developer that is responsible for that service. And if they have an idea they want to try out and they insist on trying it out in production, they are free to do so. And the job of the DBA is to care about developers breaking the database before and after the breakage, basically. That is a very different role of a DBA than in other companies where the DBAs are pretty much the guardians of the data and are responsible for secure and uninterrupted operations of the database. That is not the job of our DBAs. Our DBA job is, like everybody's job in operations, to care for the developers. That's the only thing they do. It's the developer's job to not break stuff. We can advise them, we can't stop them. What we did here with the entire project is we made migrations, database upgrades, part of normal operations. This is no longer abnormal. It's no longer an incident or even a problem. It is regular operations. We have the new version. We decide we trust the new version. And then we, la ola, in a big wave, we roll that stuff out as fast as possible. And that is a regular operation, so we can even roll out minor versions, 5.6.10, 5.6.11, 5.6.12. We don't care. To any subset of databases in any time, as fast as the network and the disks will go. That means we are giving the management options. The upgrade decision, sorry, is based on features and benefits and not on cost and manpower. It's a completely different view from the management side of things on upgrades. And when management says, or when the product owners and the DBAs agree on, we found this or that version to be useful and stable, and we would like to have it available across production next month, this is something we can do. That means we are keeping the organization agile because we are preventing technical debt, old versions, from building up in the first place. That is why we are doing this. It's infrastructure work. It's actually not business work, so it's a waste of DBA and development resources from the point of view of an agile organization. But this is what we need to be able to do in order to prevent us from clogging up, from becoming ossified, and in order to stay agile. So the situation right now is we're still not using 5.6 because this is very hard to see, but this is a 5.5 load test, and this is a 5.6 load test under the same load, and this is a CPU graph. You can see that the load rises faster and sharper, and that the load up to 2,400%, up to 24 CPU cores fully loaded, goes up quicker, whereas here the front ends fail and the database aborts the load test at 2,000% load, and it's the front end that run out of CPU and not the database with 5.5. So something is not quite right. In this particular replication hierarchy, in others with different load, it performs very well, and we are very extremely satisfied. And we are currently in the process of debugging the situation here. And when we understand this problem better and have a solution for that, we will actually press the button and then unleash La Ola across our systems. The setup you just saw, it takes 12 front-end blades instead of 4 in order to reach that point. So it does not happen in normal operations. We do load test in production by taking real customers and playing with load balancer weights and are focusing then on fewer and fewer front ends. Or we're taking the queries and are focusing them on fewer and fewer slave databases. And then we see what happens and how the database overloads. We have for front end tests, for example, a siege. A load generator that very slowly generates load in the front ends. We are not using this to actually produce load, but to measure latency. And when we hit the hockey stick, when we see that latency goes up, we know that we have reached saturation point, then we push very, very carefully, very, very slightly to actually see error 500s, not ready in time in the Perl diagnostics. And then we know that we have overloaded the system by exceeding response time limits. And then we know breakage point, that is capacity. And in normal production, we stay away from that point. We stay away from that point even by hardware because we do not have enough front-end blades per database to actually overload the databases. So it's always the front-ends that die first out of CPU, unless the developers come up with a revolutionary way to have Perl run with less CPU. Even then, you can see that something is not quite right with 5.6, and that is why we're holding it back. This is the hockey stick. This is the offered load here. And here you reach saturation, and then response times go up very suddenly, because this is the think time, and then you add wait time. What you can do also on this plot is you can make the plots bigger if the number of errors at that offered load level at that measurement point is bigger. Then you will see that you have very small dots here. And here, when it goes up, some of these dots suddenly become very large blobs because there are very many errors at that point. So when you're reaching this inflection point here, then you are also increasing the number of errors because of not ready in time and overload. And this is 5-6 under the same situation. It reaches saturation earlier and it rises quicker. And you will see then the error plots are about the same if you plot them as well. But this is the hockey stick curve when you see it, and this is what the proper load test looks like. If you're not reaching this point ever, you're not doing your load test right, and you don't know what your capacity is. So you will die eventually a very sudden and violent death. Anyway, that's the current situation. And we hope to be ready very soon now, once we understand what MySQL 5.6 does differently from we expected to do. Then we will be able to roll it out very quickly. And everything else that comes after that, we will also be able to roll out as fast. Thank you. Come to Amsterdam. It's a very nice city.
Other questions? So we reached the break, but if you want to. Some questions? Totally crashed. I only saw that BitTorrent is just for decentralized cloud movie backup, but you can use it for other stuff. Some questions? Yeah?
A question regarding to your slave amount. Are there some percentages or amounts of slave how can fail until you reach a critical point?
Sorry, come again.
Regarding to your slave amounts for your database, are there some percentages or amounts of slaves that can fail until you reach a critical point to react?
Yeah. Because we are an agile organization and we allow developers to break stuff, we need to have a certain amount of overcapacity.